नमो नमः। निधये सर्वविद्यानां भिषजे भवरोगिणां गुरवे सर्वलोकानां दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः। ऑनरेबल स्वामी जी, ऑनरेबल चेयरमैन सर प्रोफेसर रमेशचंद सिन्हा जी, ऑनरेबल प्रोफेसर एस आर भट्ट साहब, प्रोफेसर संजय पासवान जी, ऑनरेबल मूसा रजा जी एंड सम मोर स्कॉलर्स, प्रोफेसर पनीर सिल्वम जी एंड सम मोर स्कॉलर्स फ्रॉम डिफरेंट पार्ट्स ऑफ कंट्री। आई वांटेड टू कम टू दिस कॉन्फ्रेंस एंड ज्वाइन द कॉन्फ्रेंस इन ऑफलाइन मोड, बट माई हेल्थ डजंट अलाउ मी टू कम, देयरफॉर आई कैंसल यस्टरडे माई टिकट्स। Somehow I am suffering with cold and cough, and that is, you know, it is very difficult to travel in that situation. Therefore, I will keep my address also brief. So the conference is on very pertinent topic: the role of education in peace. So here, the point is this one, that what type of education can bring peace? Because we are giving education and there are different kinds of educations. There are different vidyas. If I talk of in the Indian way of saying, there are different vidyasthanas. So all those vidyasthanas don't care about peace. And what should be inculcated, what should be taught, and how should be taught so that this world becomes more peaceful and more livable. Let me point out a few facts. It appears to us, seeing the scenario, present scenario, just a few days ago, I think I am audible. So, a few days ago, okay. So, a few days ago only, in Afghanistan, Taliban took over the charge. And also we are facing a great difficulty, a pandemic, after almost 100 years. That is corona pandemic, and it is becoming almost 2 years. We are suffering in a very difficult situation. So what is required for peace? There are so many things which are required for peace. What is known as, there are some basic needs. If those basic needs are not fulfilled, we cannot think about peace. And basic needs are all the persons, not the persons belonging to only one country, only one state, only one district, or only one village. But in all over the country, we have a kind of affinity to everybody. Therefore, there is generosity. Whenever we feel, we see someone in pain, whenever we see someone dying, whenever we see someone suffering, we also suffer. It is not the case that we could be happy when someone is suffering, because not only our suffering makes us suffer, but the suffering of all other beings also. In a different way, it will be very right to say that we all are living in an interconnected universe. we all are connected. But the problem is this one, that we all are ridden, caught by our own ego. We are in a competitive state. We are trying to compete. And in this competition, what is happening? You can see that in this whole world, some countries are having so much money, and some countries are like Ethiopia, etc., are not having very basic needs. So the problem is there in this world, and we have to make this world a better one. But if we try to understand the situation of this world in an historical perspective, there is a very positive picture. A psychologist, Professor Steven Pinker from Harvard University, have written some very beautiful, engaging books. His one book is very important in this sense, The Better Angels of Our Nature. And in this book, he highlighted that the worst incident which we remember appears to be Hitler's act which he did during World War. But if you see it historically, just think about Genghis Khan. When Genghis Khan was there, he wiped out 1/6 population of the whole world. Just imagine. And a comparison to that, Hitler did only a little bit. So why there is such kind of thing? We are making a progress. And the science talks about in this way that we are having, because nowadays we are having changed perspective. The Honorable Governor of Kerala spoke about very beautiful thing, that if there is liberty, equality, then only you can have peace. And he very beautifully quoted the Sanskrit shloka from Gita, Shunicha Iva Swapakecha Pandita Samadarshana. I would also like to quote one shloka from Gita. And it is said many times that Gita argues for war. But in the same Gita, it is said to Krishna Arjuna that Ishvara Sarva Bhutanam Hiddeshe Arjuna Tishthat. O Arjun, God lives in everybody. So if God lives in everybody, that makes a very different case. Whenever you are going to worship God, this is not needed. You should go to a temple. It will be sufficient if you love the humanity. If you love all the persons. Therefore, it is said, Pandita Samadarshina. And that is the aim of life. In Indian perspective, Indian philosophical tradition, this is very clearly stated in every philosophy. That is a very unique point to note. That in every philosophy except one, Charvaka, and which is known as Lokayata philosophy. And the traditionally people don't consider that it is a kind of philosophy. Many objections are also there regarding that. But all other philosophies of India, This is accepted the whole purpose of every philosophy, that we should get rid of our ego. We should have, this is not necessary that you believe in God. And this is very unique case, I think, that in India, we have two major religions who don't believe in God, like Buddhism and also Jainism. And even Jainism is a such kind of religion which teaches that every human being, and not only every human being, but every being is capable of becoming God, like God. There is no God who created this universe, but there is someone who is omniscient, and everybody has the capacity to become. But what one has to do? The one thing one has to do, that get rid of all these limitations, all these ego problems. And if all these ego problems are not given up, then there is no peace. In Indian tradition, there is another point also that is to be noted. It is said that earlier there was an age when people were happy, much happier. Dharme naiva praja sarva rakshantisma parasparam. So that was the situation that is known as Satya Yuga. Everybody was acting according to dharma, and there was no need of any king, because there was no crime. If there is no crime, there is no need of punishment. Such kind of, and many times it appears that this was a joke. How could it be possible? But just think about it. India is a rich country in this sense that only in India there are six seasons, and there is no time when there is no food available. And the limitations were very limited. Needs were very limited. And the people were sharing and caring. And when you share, when you care for others, you become happy. Just see, Mother Teresa came here, and she served. Why? I think that she found peace doing it. And now also, you can find such persons who find pleasure in helping others. And actually, when we help others, we don't help actually, that we will be rewarded for that. That is the first position. It is said in Indian philosophical tradition, karma phala vyavastha. What you perform, you are responsible for that, and you have to enjoy the fruits of that, those doings. But this is the beginning point. And for the sthita pragya, who achieve the knowledge, who realized the true nature of things, like tathagata, sthita pragya, arahat, for them, there is no one different from them. And that is the ultimate goal of life. And how this goal is achieved, and one has to perform actions for that one. No action should be performed which goes against those values. Therefore, every act is limited by, governed by dharma. And if every act is governed by dharma, then peace comes when you behave, when you act for the sake of truth, for the sake of virtues, for the sake of dharma, then even when you get defeated, you don't worry. Because you fought for dharma, because you fought for truth. Therefore, it is always advised that dharmo rakshati rakshika. When you act, when you keep the protect dharma, you are protected. But one point must be remembered. This dharma is not a religion. It is neither Hindu dharma. It is neither Islam dharma, neither Christianity, neither Jaina dharma. But dharma is very unique concept of Indian philosophy and India. And it is many times said, dharmam yo badhate dharma na sa dharma kuvart matat. If one dharma is contradicting other dharma, then that is not dharma. That is the wrong path. One should not follow. One should not go on that path. So how to decide what is dharma? Only one thing is there. The Indian philosophical tradition says it, that if you have to decide it, you have to make your antahkarana free from those all attachments, those all aversions. Raga dvesha vimuktatma vishayan indriyaischara. So when you are free from raga and dvesha, then you can decide. Actually, you are not governed by your passions now. What is told in Western philosophical tradition, that passion makes one corrupt, but reason gives knowledge. Here, it is not in this way divided, but it is said that one has to be free from all these attachments, all these aversions. Then it becomes very clear, and therefore you can see in Indian philosophical tradition, when we talk about Nyaya philosophy, when we talk about Samkhya philosophy, when we talk about Jaina, Buddhist philosophy, any philosophy you take, the Achara Marga is very much similar in all of them. And so much similar that even it becomes hardly possible to differentiate. Therefore, in order to be happy, in order to have a peaceful world, there is a great need to teach this Indian wisdom. This education must be cultivated to the children, to the persons, so that we have a better world, we have a peaceful world. Thank you very much. I can't speak so much more today, because I'm finding some difficulties. So thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. And please forgive me that I could not attend this conference in offline mode. Thank you very much, Swamiji and some other scholars. Thank you.